So let me recall what I was saying yesterday when I finished my lecture. So we were considering this simple Destoy example of a scalar field theory. We had come to the conclusion that, I had illustrated that the most general Lagrangian for this system can be split into four terms. There is a kinetic term that corresponds to the kinetic term of a free massless particle. Then there are other three classes of operators depending on the scaling, classical scaling with the energy of the corresponding couplings. There are operators of dimension strictly less than four. Remember that di here means the dimension of the operator minus four, okay? Then there were operators of dimension exactly equal to four. And in these two classes, understandably, there are only finitely many operators. And then there is the class of operators where di is bigger than zero. And here, this is an infinite class corresponding to operators of arbitrarily high dimension. One comment, these operators have coefficients that will depend with the energy scale. via quantum effects, okay, at the quantum level. However, with the exception of this one, all these other operators affect physical amplitudes also with powers of energies associated with the genuine dimension of the coefficient. So already at the classical level, even without quantum effects, and we discussed that, we saw that these operators lead to effects that are proportional to positive, lead to corrections to amplitudes that have relative size proportional to a power, positive power of energy, while in this case we have effects that are proportional to negative powers of energy. For instance, a mass term will have effect proportional to the mass square over e square, relative effects, okay? We're always using dimensional, adimensional quantities to evaluate the relevance, the importance, if you want, the importance of a given parameter, a given coupling. And here there are terms that are classically even, they don't depend on energy, but quantum mechanically they do. And then there was this, there's this term, this is the kinetic term. Notice that when we do standard renormalization, we often also get renormalizations of this term. Okay, you can get one plus so-called wave function normalization. But this normalization can be absorbed in the definition of the field. The field phi in the path integral is a dummy variable, is an integration variable. So we can always redefine it suitably up to an overall constant in the path integral in the normalization. So, but in the genuinely, this is an integration variable which we can redefine. And redefining this variable in the following way, as you know very well, we can bring this term into its original form. And this redefinition only has impact on all the other terms, okay? In particular, it rescales each coupling corresponding to the number of legs of phi it has, okay? The fact that there is one operator that can always be kept in the same form corresponds to the fact that there is one linear combination of these all terms here, this and that, which is can be eliminated by field redefinition. And in the language of the renormalization group, such combination is called a redundant term, okay? So using this redundancy, you can always put this, the first term in this form. And now that we have done that, you can now interpret the structure in the following way. This Lagrangian consists of, I'm repeating what I said yesterday, perhaps more slowly now because I have 1 hour and a half, so I can say it slowly. So this term corresponds to, you see, it's a massless. It's the Lagrangian that describes the propagation of a massless free scalar. The massless can also be stated equivalently by saying that this Lagrangian is scale invariant. Scale invariant and free is amounts to say massless. Okay, so we have a leading term which is basically the same at all scales, and it corresponds to a. It has the structure of a scale invariant free Lagrangian. And then there are these terms, as you remember here, we have terms where, like the mass term or the trilinear coupling, whose importance grows as you go to lower energy. So the effective dimensionless parameters associated to these guys go like some quantum scaling, E, times some power to the minus di. Okay. So for instance, the mass, for the mass squared, the corresponding lambda 2 parameter is simply given by m square e, involving the quantum scaling and the classical scaling. Okay. This is if you want to evaluate how important the effects of mass are at energy e, at leading accuracy, you can just say, well, they are 1 over e squared, and there are also some slow dependence on RG evolution, which is due to the effects of all the other couplings. And these guys here evolve purely because of quantum mechanical effect. And as we discussed, quantum mechanical effect can bring them over either to this side or to that side. I forgot to say, these operators in this class are called, and I insist again, are called relevant, meaning they are important in the infrared, and the infrared is the range of energies that we can test in the cheapest way. And since we are poor, things that we can test at low energy are called relevant, okay? And then there is this class here, which we call marginal, and they are the effects that classically, they are equally important at all scales, but quantum mechanically, quantum effects can make them either relevant, namely grow at low energy, like in the case of QCD coupling, or irrelevant, that is belonging to the third class, the class of irrelevant operators. That is the operators that become less and less important as you go to low energy. An example of that, of this mildly irrelevant coupling, is the gauge coupling of QED. Okay, So the picture is therefore that we have as we change the energy scale, as we perform experiments at energies that are varied. Okay, we can do the same experiment at E over 10, E over 100. So we go to lower and lower energies, to longer and longer distances. We will describe what we can describe. Our the result of our experiments in terms of the evolution with energy of these effective couplings. Okay, we can describe the outcome of our experiment in terms of a flow in the space of coupling. Okay, and the overall thing, it can be viewed as what do these couplings describe? As long as we are at weak coupling, they describe perturbative deformations of a free massless scalar. Okay, so we have the unperturbed limit, which is a scale invariant trivial theory. It's a free massless scalar, and the change in energy in the energy of experiment describes a flow in the in the space of the deformations. We can call these as deformations of free massless scalar field theory. Okay. And now the free massless scalar field theory is not if we had only in the limit where lambda I are equal to zero, in this limit we have a free massless theory, and that it's a scale invariant theory. So what we have is that we can just draw a picture. There is a point in parameter space, lambda, okay? And this is the free, we can say this is the origin if you want in this. Now, this is an infinite parameter space. I draw it as a two-dimensional space, but it's an infinite parameter space. And there is the origin of this space, which is the free theory. And the change with energy will describe a flow. Okay, we start at a point and we flow in this. Okay, in this space. This is just the picture. And I emphasize what I already said, that one striking feature of viewing quantum field theory in this perspective is that the vast majority of the structure that you have in the theory, this theory has infinitely many parameters, which is characterized by all these high dimension operators that are the analog of higher multiples in classical electrodynamics, becomes less and less important, less and less relevant, that is to say irrelevant at the lower scales, to the point that at sufficiently low energy and at finite precision, you can consistently cut your Lagrangian to the first three points, for first three terms, the kinetic term, the relevant ones, and the marginal ones. Okay, and this is what we call this corresponds to the normalizable Lagrangians that have such a great fame in particle physics, and that's the reason why. Okay. Now, when you think it's interesting here. I cannot stop making this comment that often we think, and you hear, and we say that particle physics, as compared to other branches of science, I don't know, sociology or even geology, is simple. It has very simple laws because it's fundamental. It's because fundamental for some reason is simpler. There are a few parameters. In this respect, particle physics at sufficient low energy is simple. Okay, if you want, particle physics is simple. Particle physics, as described by a normalizable Lagrangian, is simple simply because it is not fundamental. Because there is the whole structure, it's gone away. Like, it's very similar to when you take a metal. No matter what the metal is, whether it's iron, whether it's a league, whether it's whatever, the very, very long distance physics is determined by phonons. Okay, and no matter how different is the atomic and subatomic structure, the leading phenomenon at very, very long, very, very long wavelength, it's phonon propagation. And the only parameter that matters in that is the speed of the phonons, the speed of sound, okay? So you see, all objects are very, very different, but at the end, the parameters describe it as just few. And it's just the result of looking at. So it could well be that the fundamental physics underlying particle physics is incredibly complicated, and perhaps it's not even irrational, who knows, okay? Just that for some reason, this very complicated physics let the appearance of a separation of scales so that we can look at phenomena from very long wavelengths. We have very long wavelength quanta, and their physics is unavoidably simple. Now, it goes without saying that this the statement that I made here for this simple theory with the scalar applies to the standard model and all its low energy variants, low energy QED, the chiral Lagrangian of QCD with QED, the standard model below the charm threshold, the standard model below the W. So it is the way you can view the standard model. In the standard model, the analog of this term is just the kinetic term of all the particles, the gluons, the Ws, Higgs without including mass terms. So very, very high energy in the standard model, it has that. Then there are the relevant part here is just the Higgs mass. Then there are all the gauge coupling and Yukawa coupling, and then there are all sorts of irrelevant things, okay? I will discuss that better tomorrow, okay? So this applies certainly to the case that we're interested in and that are motivated by observation of nature. Another thing that I should say is that, and going back, to specify better this notion of simplicity, okay? The notion of simplicity. As I said, simplicity means that you reduce the number of parameters unavoidably. It's just a dynamical fact. These parameters are affecting physical quantities less and less. It's intrinsic in the notion of simplicity, the notion of enhanced symmetries, okay? Let me repeat again the example of the cow, okay? You take the cow, okay? You take the simple cow. Now I draw it, hopefully I draw it well. It's laughing. Okay, there's this cow. Okay, you look at it, it's a complex object. It's, in particular, it's not invariant under rotations. Okay, you look at it upside down, it will look very different, okay? On the other hand, if you go on a hike, you go on the top of a mountain, you look at the cow at the bottom of the valley, the cow will look like a point. In fact, if the mountain is sufficiently high and you're given your eyes, you will just see a point, okay? And the point looks the same in all directions. You turn it upside down. If the cow is like that, you will not notice, okay? And the phenomenon that you can describe here is you go from a system which has no symmetry, rotational invariance, to a system which has an accidental, which is invariant under SO3, as far as you can tell, okay? It looks the same in all directions, so it's esotropic, so it's SO3. You gained a symmetry, okay? And that's a phenomenon. It's exactly the phenomenon that appears over and over in quantum field theory, okay? So for instance, and I will comment on that more tomorrow, but you can meditate, for instance, on the reason why parity is so famous, okay, in low energy physics, okay? Just the fact, and you can check, in fact, do it as an exercise, you can check that parity is an accidental symmetry of quantum electrodynamics, very much like SO3 is an accidental symmetry of a faraway cow, okay? So, which is to say that if you take QED, if you take the Lagrangian, which involves a photon, with a gauge symmetry and an electron, okay, a charge fermion, and you write the most general Lagrangian, as I did here, you write all the terms, okay, and you will realize that at the level of the kinetic term, which is the scale invariant part, the irrelevant thing, the mass term, the interaction, which is the gauge coupling, there's an accidental symmetry, which you did not ask for, that is parity, okay? And this symmetry is broken as soon as you consider operators in this class. As soon as you go to operators in factor of dimension 6, you can break it, okay? But if the scale where you do experiments in quantum electrodynamics sufficiently low compared to the scale which controls the structure, which in the case of QED is the weak scale, then parity will appear as an accidental symmetry without it being fundamental, okay? It's just a simplification which emerges simply because, for some reason, the electron mass and the physics with QD happens at scales which are much, much lower than the fundamental scale of the whole underlying theory, which is the standard model. So, and this notion of accidental symmetry is also very important, in my opinion, to appreciate the paradoxes of the standard model, namely to say the hierarchy paradox, and that will be discussed tomorrow. Okay, so what can I say? Yeah, okay, now I can erase something. Oh, there is, so enough about this part. Now, what about what is left when you go to low energy? Now, as it is totally evident in this case, the relevant part of the Lagrangian, sooner or later, will become very, very relevant, okay? Because this coupling grow, the effects here grows with energy, Like for instance, the mass. The example is the mass is the mass term of this Lagrangian, which whose effects we evaluated in this way. Eventually, if the energy is low enough, which is to say of the order of the mass, the deformation provided by the mass to the original theory will be large. Okay, so we will be order one away. Okay. From the original fixed point, okay? The theory will flow. We say in that case that the theory has flown away from the original fixed point, okay? And entered, given that some coupling now is becoming large, this coupling is discombobulating all the structure. Now, with the, no, normally, the given that there's a coupling which is providing a big perturbation, the previous picture that there is this massless scalar slightly perturbed is no longer valid. We normally have to get to a new description. In the specific case of the scalar of this theory here, it's very simple. Below energy even lower than the mass, there's nothing. So the empty theory. Okay, there's no more experiments we can make. It's just the empty theory. In other cases, like in QCD, what happens? See, I'm just giving the qualitative notions. I'm not proving anything. Okay, I'm just telling you stories. So in QCD, what happens is that one of the marginal couplings, the QCD coupling, becomes order one, becomes strong, and then very complicated physics takes place, which we don't yet fully understand. We don't understand confinement, and out of the fundamental degrees of freedom we had originally, the quarks and the gluons, we enter into a new regime, and what emerges when we now perform experiments at lower and lower energies, which is below 1 GeV, is a different theory with different degrees of freedom, also weakly coupled now, but totally different dynamics. This is the physics of the pions. Now, in real life, pions also have a mass, and this new dynamics does not go on for much. You go from 1 GeV to about 100 MeV, at which scale the pions have a mass, you integrate them out, and you end up basically in the empty theory as far as QCD is concerned. You are only left with neutrinos, the electron, muon, and the photon. And then you go on and on, okay? But the basic idea is that you linger in the vicinity of this fixed point, okay, for a while as you flow, and at a certain point, but eventually, if you have any relevant coupling, this relevant coupling will grow, will become of order one, and then you will need to have a new description. So examples of new description are the empty theory, like in the scalar, or the presence of new weakly interacting bound states, like in the case of QCD, the pions. Or it could even happen, and we have indications. We're way now to understand that, using particular supersymmetry and other insights. It could also happen that the theory flows to a new regime, okay, and to a new fixed point. That is, for instance, believed to be the case in QCD with a sufficiently large number of flavors, okay? Not too large to make it asymptotically non-free, but somewhere in the between, it is believed that, and there is indication also from the lattice, it's coming in recent years, although I don't know, it's, according to different people, there's different level of acceptance. But anyway, this is very well understood instead in the case of supersymmetry. So there is also the option to have the theory to flow, okay, to a new fixed point, okay, which is an interacting scale invariant theory, okay. So you got from the vicinity of a free fixed point and you flow, and beyond that point, if you perform experiments, the scaling will be trivial. In other words, there will be no. You consider amplitude and they all scale in a given way with energy. So basically, it's the most boring thing that can happen. Nothing changes with energy. Okay, it's everything is totally immanent. It's like frozen. This is what we call a scale invariant theory. It's boring from the point of view of experiments, if you want, in this respect. And there's no, but the this class of theories is actually very interesting from the point of view of mathematical physics and also from the theory of critical phenomena. There's lots of other things. In particular, it's interesting to study perturbations around these fixed points. Okay. In fact, very much in the same way I described things here, as soon as you approach the, if that is the case, as soon as you approach the vicinity of this fixed point, and this is you can in those cases use a different picture, where the Lagrangian is now described again in terms of four pieces, but the first piece, the one which is scale invariant, let me call it scale invariant field theory, okay, SFT. For the moment, let me use the word SFT. I'll get to something else in 10 minutes. This is a scale invariant field theory. Scale invariant interacting field theory. So the notion of symmetry is a robust notion. Before we had a scale invariant free theory, but the real essence of this term here was that it looked the same. It had the same relevance, same importance at all scales. It was not the fact that it was free, what was really essential about it. I mean, it was essential that it was free because we had a perturbative picture, so we were considering perturbation theory, standard perturbation theory, and then we were bound to have a free Lagrangian as a starting point. With a little bit of imagination, you can, however, conceive the situation, and we know examples of that, where the role of the scale invariant piece is not played by a free theory, but a non-trivial interacting theory. Okay, and then it's exactly the same way. Around this non-trivial interacting theory, we can characterize its deformation, in other words, its deviation from the fixed points, in terms of three classes of parameters. Well, actually two, if you want, but it's again two. It's actually, well, relevant, marginal, and irrelevant. And the marginal, very often, if you look carefully, they are either marginally relevant or marginally relevant. In some really specific cases, there are exactly marginal operators. But you see, having an exactly marginal operators is non-trivial. I mean, a marginal operator is very similar to a flat direction in a potential. Okay? You can view of that. It's a dimension. So the fact that under all possible quantum corrections, the scaling of a coupling is not changed is very similar to assuming that there's a potential which is zero, and then you compute quantum fluctuation and it stays flat. And situations like that, in the case of the potential, are known to happen in the case of supersymmetry. And in fact, the case of supersymmetry is, as far as I can tell, maybe some of the experts can correct me if I'm wrong, it's the only case where we can say that we can definitely say that there exists exactly marginal deformation. In other words, coupling that deform the fixed point and in such a way that the new point is fixed. That's really amount to the fact that the fixed point is not a point but a manifold. Okay. So that there is a manifold of fixed points parametrized by the exactly marginal couplings of the theory. Okay, that's something that happens in supersymmetric gauge theories, and also in the corresponding ADS-CFT descriptions. any questions? Any comments? Eh? No, there's no difference. There's no difference. I could take these and put them here, and now if I turn them on, there's a new. You're right. I can swap them in this. You're right. If I turn on this deformation, I say, okay, it's scaling invariant. So let me put it here, and now I have new. The point around which I'm expanding is different. Is this one okay? And. Yeah. There are examples. There are examples in supersymmetric gauge theories where at strong coupling, some irrelevant operators can become relevant. So an operator of dimension in the superpotential, an operator of dimension 4, So which is irrelevant in the superpotential. Your practice with supersymmetry, right? So the relevant, the marginal one are like phi cube, right, in superpotential. There are phi to the fourth that become, that at the fixed point become phi cube. In fact, I think they can even become relevant. Let me give you an example also. You can even think of simpler examples. Let me see of an example, okay? So imagine. Can you imagine Technicolor? Have you heard about Technicolor? So Technicolor is a theory where imagine the standard model, turn off all the interactions of the standard model. Okay? Turn off all the interactions. Okay? The standard model is completely free. And the only interaction you have is, so there is a standard model. So this is just a very simple, a trivial realization of what you're asking me. So there are non-trivial realization in supersymmetry. You can look at this paper by Lee and Strassler, okay, of what I was saying before, okay. I think there's only one paper, probably two, I don't know. And I think, if I'm correct, this is 20 years ago, there is in this, it's a beautiful paper. There are examples of these lines of fixed points. And there's also an example of an operator of dimension 4 that at the fixed points becomes either dimension 3 or relevant. So that's an example, which is totally possible, right? Totally logical. But let me give you a more handmade example, okay? So consider a standard model, free, plus some Technicolor sector, okay, which is a new gauge theories where there are new fermions that have quantum numbers under some new gauge symmetry, okay, and in this, the two sectors can only talk to each other via operator of dimension 4, which is the Techni fermions times the standard model fermion. They are suppressed by some, I don't know, M Planck square, some things like that. Okay. You see what I'm saying? So there are two gauge theories. They can only, they have different symmetries. They can only talk about dimension 4. So this operator is irrelevant. Okay. It's a dimension 6. Okay. But now you go across the scale where this becomes strong. Okay. Where there is some new dynamics. These guys confine. They condense and they form a condensate, and this guy here becomes lambda cube FF bar M Planck square. So it becomes a fermion mass term, which is an operator of dimension 3. So it's a stupid example. Yeah, it's a stupid example. But this is just showing you the effect of this operator becomes less and less and less important as you go down in energy, okay? Until you reach the scale where boom, this guy is condensed, and this spits out a mass term, and then the importance of this will grow as you go to lower energy until you get to the mass of the fermion, and that will be of order one. That's an example. That's if you want. If you're not happy with this example, that's all there is, and this is just showing to you that this is possible. And this is a much clever case where it's just the same field that appears there. It's just one chiral superfield, and it's just its own interaction that changed the scaling. Please. No. No. No, to tell you the truth, probably I'm too young and too responsible, but I never understood why people were working on this triviality. But let me tell you my story. Let me tell you the way I would set the problem, okay? So you have lambda phi to the fourth, and people want to know whether there exists a continuum limit of lambda phi to the fourth. Now, of course, there exists a continuum limit. All you need to have is to embed lambda phi to the fourth at some scale into a theory that goes to an asymptotically free theory. Okay, you can do it. Okay, and there are infinitely many ways to do it. You can do it at weak coupling and a strong coupling. These people probably wanted to insist in getting continuum limit without adding new degrees of freedom. But as soon as you get to strong coupling, even the notion of what the degrees of freedom is unclear to me. Okay, how do you count degrees of freedom at strong coupling? How do you define? I mean, all you have is operators and correlators. So to me, really thinking, I don't know, probably Valeri has some comments. I don't know what these people wanted to achieve. That's my opinion. In the infrared, yes, sure. In the far infrared, it is. Yeah. Or that, if you want, that corresponds to triviality, sure. In that respect, that is triviality, yeah. If you take, but, yeah, sure. But the phi to the fourth theory also has a mass term. It eventually will. You have to really put the mass. If you put the mass term, if you put the mass exactly to zero, then eventually the theory will be free. Very much like in QED, also QED is trivial. Also, QED is trivial, very much like lambda phi to the four. There's no difference, okay? If you set the electron mass to zero, as we were discussing yesterday, Coulomb physics at long distances will be very, very different than we have in QED with mass, because the potential will not go like 1 over r, will go like 1 over r log r. It will go to zero faster than 1 over r, corresponding to the fact that the theory is trivial in the infrared, okay? In the very far infrared, yeah. Sure. So examples of these interacting scale invariant theories. Let me recall for your just for information. Okay? We have now in the last 40 years. Other people, not me, able to come up with a set of examples. So the first example, I believe, were via the epsilon expansion. Cosa? It's a nice phone. Okay, it's. Okay. I turned it off. Okay. So the epsilon expansion going to 4 minus epsilon dimension, this is the Wilson and Fischer found interacting fixed points. You may object that these are not exactly fixed points in 4 dimensions. They are in 4 minus epsilon. So they are examples, but they're not exactly what you would be totally excited about. They are interesting because they give you some perspective on three-dimensional physics, for instance, critical phenomena in three dimensions, okay, three space dimension, are even surprisingly well understood, well accounted for quantitatively by doing an epsilon expansion and taking epsilon equal to one, okay. Perhaps more interesting in four dimension, there are some large n fixed points that you can construct in ordinary gauge theories with matter, and these are what is known as Banach-Zaks. How do you put the CK or not? Banach-Zaks, I think. This was in the 80s, but as it is, I say to Valeri, it's always the case. They were anticipated by Belavin and Migdal a few years before. So there's always a Russian paper that comes before. And this is a way of constructing fixed points just using gauge theories and taking a limit where the number of colors and number of flavors goes to infinity in a specific ratio, okay? And in such a way that you can reliably, if you want, we can discuss that tomorrow, okay, if you want, or in the discussion section, I can illustrate how it works. It's not essential for this course. But it's just to tell you to go and check these papers, okay? This is a very nice, you can really do computations, okay, using this. And as often when you do things in a reliable way, really computation, it means that you have some expansion parameter, okay? And in this case, the expansion parameter is the size of the beta function, which is normally of order n, but there are number of colors minus number of flavors divided by n itself. And if the number of colors, number of flavors, given that affect the beta function with opposite signs, are chosen in particular way, this term is very, this ratio is very small, and that is the expansion parameter of your, that makes your computation reliable. You always need an expansion parameter when you do explicit computations like that. There are other cases instead where you use symmetry and consistency in a very non-trivial way to establish that there are these fixed points, and this is in the case of supersymmetry. Here, you do not rely on small parameters, not necessarily. And these examples of that are the n equal 1 fixed points found by Seiberg, and also n equal 4, Young-Mills, okay? And I should go below, okay? There's the for n equal 4, Young-Mills, and for a great variety of other theories, you can establish that there are conformal field theories and describe them in terms of the so-called ADS-CFT correspondence, okay? So we have now a very large array of examples of non-trivial interacting scale invariant theory. Oh, I say conformal. Okay, I say scale invariant. Okay, I'll tell you in a moment better. Okay, so these are all examples that have scale invariants and are non-interacting. Now, one important thing which is worth just to mention, in the case of free field theory, in the case of free field theory, in the case of the theory discussed before, and also in the case of the standard model, as I said, you're considering a free theory as the unperturbed case, free massless theory, and then you write all the operators. Now, and all these operators have the scaling of their coefficient comes from two effects. One is classical and the other is quantum. Given that we are perturbative, the quantum effects, it's a small effect. And the dimension is dominated by the quantum, by the classical dimension. And the classical dimension amounts at simply counting the powers of the fields and the powers of derivatives, and the field has dimension 1, scalar, and Fermi has dimension 3/2, and derivative dimension 1. So the net result of this is that the dimension of operators are always approximately integers in the case of approximately free theory, okay? They're just around integer values. While in the case of non-trivial interacting theories, the dimensions can be basically whatever, okay? There are some constraints that come from unitarity and other fundamental principles, but they can take any rational, irrational value, okay? So in particular, you can have dimensions that are not 4, but 4 minus a tenth, okay? That's conceivable, okay? And you will see more of this later. Okay, any questions? Please. If you consider the scattering amplitude, so this is again this is an operator of dimension 6, right? So its impact in any its relative effect on any observable will be scaling like E square at already at the classical level over MP square. It's just as simple as that. For fermion Green's function. Compute the TT bar to FF bar amplitude. Okay, you will have fermion, you have the U, the Vs of fermion, those contains powers of energy when you do it. So when you compute the cross-section, this is like, yeah, it's hidden there. Each power of the fermion takes a square root of V with it. Any more questions? Okay, so if not, here I touched upon, so as you understand quantum field theory, so we have this scale invariant piece plus its deformations. So it is therefore important, okay, to understand better the role of scale invariance in quantum field theory, given that this is the Ambertur part of all the flows that we can consider. So let me now open a parenthesis on that, okay? So this is a bit out of the flow of the discussion. But it is relieving to me because this is a technical part, so it's easy to discuss. It's equations, things. I think it's also sufficiently precise. So, in fact, I should say scale invariance, let me say it better, scale invariance and conformal invariance. In QFT, okay. So as I said, I talked about a physics that doesn't change your scale. So the intrinsically a change of scale can be viewed as a change of variables, okay, dilatation, and there are two dilatations, transformations that you can think of that are relevant. Okay, there are two sort of dilatation that you can do in Minkowski space, in fact, in Euclidean space also. So one is this one. Okay, you just rescale your coordinates, which just amounts to take your grid, and you change the grid to a possibly bigger grid. Okay. Just change your units, the unit which you parameterize space-time. At the differential level, this just means that everywhere you globally rescale your intervals. Okay. From the point of view of group theory, this amounts at infinitesimal level to adding to the Poincaré group, which I normally indicate by P. To the generators of the Poincaré group, the generator of dilations, okay, which is just the infinitesimal action of this. All you have to do then, all you have in this case is that you have the Poincaré group supplemented with the commutation relation dp mu translation equal I p mu. Okay, just stating the fact that p mu has dimension one, and d commutes with angular momentum. It has dimension zero, and that's it. Okay, so all you it commutes, of course, with itself. So all you have to, so you just supplement. You, instead of 10 generators, you have 11. However, there's another class of dilations that exist, and you can consider in Euclidean space and Minkowski space, which is corresponds to local dilations. This is a global dilation. This corresponds to local dilations. Okay, let me just take here. I have to take some few notes. And this is the following transformation. X mu goes to X tilde mu, which is equal to X mu plus B mu X square 1 plus B square X square plus 2 BX. Okay. this seemingly complicated transformation is a transformation that, if you look at it at the infinitesimal level, it simply rescaled infinitesimal at the local level is an overall rescaling different at different points, okay, and equal to simply 1 plus b squared plus 2bx. Sorry, let me write well, 1 plus b squared x squared plus 2bx squared dx squared. So, so at all points you simply rescale, but you rescale different at different points. So, for instance, a transformation. So the net result of this, as you can easily understand, given that all vectors are simply rescaled, the angles that two infinitesimal vectors do with respect to each other in the mapping are preserved. So lengths are changed, but angles are preserved. So, for instance, if you have a grid like this, for instance, the following. The following mapping corresponds to one of these conformal transformations. So conformal because you preserve the angles, but you rescale. This amounts to local rescaling, and you can supplement in the first case you were supplementing the Poincaré group with just dilation. If you consider conformal transformation, what you have to do is to supplement the Poincaré group with conformal transformation whose infinitesimal generator is parametrized by four Lie parameter that live in a four vector B mu, okay, and the infinitesimal transformation you call them K mu, times, and you also have to add dilations because dilations can be obtained by combining Lorentz transformations, translations and conformal transformations. So you cannot consistently have these and not have those. In fact, that's a special case of these, if you want. No, it's not exactly a special case, but it's a transformation that you obtain by combining these with translations and Lorentz transformations. So, in this case, the group has exactly, so for instance, in four dimensions, it has the structure, in fact, the dimension, in this space-time dimension, this has the here can be shown to have exactly the structure of the group OD, 2. So in particular, in four dimension, it is the group O4, 2, which is the orthogonal group in six dimensional space-time, with signature plus, 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 minus, minus, okay? And the commutation relations are just, so d mu, dp, as I said before, is ip mu, corresponding to the fact that p, as I mentioned, plus 1. The commutation of d with k mu is the opposite, k mu as the mention one over as the dimension of length, as you can read here, the Lie parameter as the dimension of one over length, and then there is a commutation of p mu with k nu, and this gives you delta mu nu eta mu nu d minus mu nu. And then there's a 2i in front of it. Okay, so these are the symmetries that we can think of when we think of dilations in four-dimensional space-time. Basically, this is the minimum you can think of, but it's worth keeping in mind that there's also this one. In fact, this one plays a very important role. Okay, now more to the point. So this is just simple mathematics. There's little more to add. So let's now come to field theory, okay? Let's now come to field theory. So consider field theory, okay? And let's consider a field theory which is scale invariant, just scale, just dilatations, okay? X mu goes to X tilde mu equal KX mu. How will the fields, so we have a set of fields, phi A is some index in the fields, could be a Lorentz index, could be the collection of all the indices. How this will change will when you do a change of coordinates like that, you will describe this in terms of a new field over the new coordinates, and this is related to the old field times some, in general there will be some rotation which depends on the parameters, on the Lie parameter. Okay? Fields could be rearranged. In fact, in principle this could even depend on the field themselves, but doesn't change much in what I'm saying. And so this is a general transformation that realizes on the fields. This is a realization, if you want, a representation of this transformation on the fields. From the point of view of the functional form of phi tilde, we can also write it phi tilde A of X equal, you can also view it this way. This is more direct. The active way to look at it. Okay. Now, with this transformation, we can now apply Noether theorem, and assuming the Lagrangian is invariant, derive the form of the conserved current. Okay. Now, notice that this transformation, this symmetry consists of two pieces. Okay, of two pieces. There's a space-time transformation, and there is a transformation which looks like an internal, ordinary internal symmetry. Okay, and I leave it to you as an exercise to show that given these two contributions to the transformation of the fields, the Noether current that you derive, okay, consists of two pieces. Okay, the first piece comes purely from the space-time transformation. Okay. And given that it's a change of coordinates, it's easy to see it from the algebra where you derive Noether theorem, that is precisely proportional to the energy momentum tensor times precisely the infinitesimal transformation. Infinitesimal transformation here, when I take K is equal 1 plus epsilon, delta X mu is equal epsilon X mu. So this is the infinitesimal transformation. So this is how it works, like T times the, if you want, the Lie parameter of the transformation, that how the coordinate changes, plus a term which is what you would get when you have an ordinary internal symmetry, some current, okay, which doesn't depend on coordinates, okay, which is purely coming from the internal. This current is just some combination of the fields of our theory, but does not involve the coordinate X. Okay, it's just obtained. It's like the current we would have for an internal symmetry. Okay, and now current concern. If the theory is scale invariant, what is very interesting about all this reasoning is that if you know the theory is scale invariant, we deduce some interesting property for the energy momentum sensor. Compute the divergence of the current, and what you find is that, okay, you get this d mu, t mu nu x nu, plus v mu. When you act with the derivative here, you act with the derivative on t mu nu, and this you get zero, because the t mu nu is conserved. When you act on there, you get a delta, Kronecker delta, so that what you get here is t mu mu. And here you get the divergence of the current itself. And this would have to be equal to zero if you have a symmetry. So the interesting implication of the presence of the symmetry is that the energy momentum tensor trace equals a total derivative. V mu. It's a total derivative, itself a total derivative, meaning to say it's an operator which when you, for instance, you insert it in a set of correlator, you integrate over volume, you get zero, because there's a total derivative in front of it, okay? So the average over the whole volume of t mu mu is zero. So it's an operator which proportion to the total derivative. It's not zero, okay, the operator. It's zero mode is zero. It's zero frequency, is zero, zero Fourier term is zero mode is zero, okay? The zero mode is zero, great, yeah. Now, just a little technical remark. You can do a little exercise. When you do the derivation I told you, the T mu nu you get here is the naive T mu nu, the one that you get offhand from the Noether procedure. This T mu nu is, in general, in theories, where you have particles with spin, is not symmetric. Okay? In order to make it, so this would be the non-symmetric T mu nu. Okay, that if you lower the index, it's not symmetric. Now, because of Lorentz invariance, as you know very well, this non-symmetric T mu nu has an additional property. Its anti-symmetric part, the anti-symmetric part, has a specific form. This just follows from Lorentz invariance. And using this information, you can improve your energy momentum tensor by what is known as the Bell-Infanten procedure. You can define what you can prove due to the presence of Lorentz invariance is that you can define a new energy momentum tensor, T mu nu, which is equal to the non-symmetric one minus dk bk mu nu, where this is a three-index tensor that exists in your theory when you, and it is related to the Lorentz transformation, to the derivative of the Lagrangian and Lorentz transformation of the field. It exists in all theories, and it has a specific property. Okay, it is so that you can construct it in any theory. It has the property of being anti-symmetric in these two indices. Bk mu nu is equal to minus b nu k mu b mu k nu, okay? Thanks to this property, this combination here is automatically conserved when you take the divergence back to mu. Here, this is trivially zero independent of the equations of motion. And thanks to the invariance under Lorentz transformation, you can there's a suitable B such that this T prime is conserved and symmetric, okay? Conserved is, of course, it's conserved, but it's also symmetric. Now, check as an exercise, okay, that using this fact, you can define a new current S prime, mu, which is conserved, which can be written as T prime mu nu x nu, and a new current V mu, okay? So basically, you can rewrite the same thing in terms of the conserved and symmetric T, okay? Only that you have to change what this vector here is, find what the new vector is. This is just a little exercise, okay? So in general, in a scale invariant theory, so for the sake of what follows, let me assume this is already symmetric, okay? Let me forget the primes. This is the symmetric one, okay? I already took that I can do things in such a way that this T is the symmetric one. So there is the statement is that in the scalar invariant theory, the energy momentum tensor is symmetric because of Lorentz, and its trace is a total derivative because of scalar invariance. Now, so this is as concerns scalar invariance. Now, there is a very interesting thing which is relevant for basically for all the theories we know, okay? But let me explain it here in general. So now, how? I mean, this is a statement about dilation invariance. Now, what would be the condition to have in addition to have in addition to scale invariance, also conformal invariance. So let me explain how it goes, okay? So now, consider now a more specific case. So this is the statement about dilatations. So the whole story is about the structure of this V mu. So Consider instead the case, consider now a more specific case, consider a more specific case. But it's not so more specific to the extent that this is basically, this is true in all, true in all the gauge, in all ordinary four-dimensional gauge theories, okay? That are also scale invariant. So let me close the parentheses, but let me consider the more specific case where V mu itself is a total derivative. This is to say V mu is equal to D nu L nu mu. Yes, okay. So imagine, so this means that T mu mu is equal, a double derivative, is equal to 2 mu D nu L mu nu, okay? So imagine this is the case. Now, it turns out that if this is the case, then you can find a further improvement of the energy-momentum tensor, okay? You can further improve the energy-momentum tensor in the following way, okay? Where can I write it? You can find a further improvement, and just check what I'm saying, okay? You can find a further improvement where you write T mu nu, you write a new theta, a new energy momentum tensor, which is conserved and symmetric, okay, T mu nu, and define it the following way. It's equal to this. Then there is minus 1/2, perhaps I have to erase this. Minus. So just using this L, I can form the following two quantities. You can check that these two quantities maintain the conservation of theta. So theta is automatically conserved. If you take the divergence of theta, this is divergenceless, okay? Just property of the energy-momentum tensor. And this one, it's divergence on the equations of motion, while this one here is automatically divergence free. Okay, this is basically, it has the same form of Einstein's equation for a perturbation of the metric. Okay, it has exactly the same form, and it is. You can check that this is divergence free, automatically, and this as well is divergence free. They're both divergence free. Okay. Automatically. So the conservation property is maintained. Symmetry is maintained. Okay, but you can check because of this property here that theta mu mu is equal to T mu mu minus, I hope I have all the signs correct, D mu D nu L mu nu, which is zero. So using the property that it exists, that there exists scale invariance, okay, there is a current V which is associated to conserved scale current in the following way. And the extra assumption that this current V is the derivative of a two-index tensor implies that you can find a further improvement in the energy-momentum tensor such that the energy-momentum tensor is not only symmetric, but it's also traceless. Okay, and with this traceless symmetric tensor, you can immediately form another set of currents. Okay, you can immediately form another set of currents. Okay, K mu nu equals to another set of currents. K mu nu equal to x theta mu rho 2 x nu x rho minus theta mu rho no minus x minus theta sorry mu nu x square. So you can form another set of currents, and you can check that these currents are conserved. Okay, these currents are conserved. Okay, these currents satisfy d mu k mu nu is proportional to the trace theta mu mu, and this is equal to zero. Just check it as an exercise. And so when that is the case, there is the additional set of currents, and a four plate of currents amounts to the presence of four additional symmetries. And if you look at this closely, you see that this is just the energy Newton tensor fudged in, multiplied by an infinitesimal conformal transformation. Okay, so under this condition, the theory not only has scale invariance, but it also has conformal invariance. Good question. I think so. Yes, it has to be symmetric. In all the cases, it's symmetric. And the reason, yeah, it is symmetric. This improvement, as I will say in a moment, are related to the addition to the Lagrangian of further terms. See, then I'll say it in a moment. But there's a very simple structural reason for that. Okay, so let me give you an example. Okay, so first of all, let me say that this apparently bizarre thing, okay, is what happens in all ordinary four-dimensional gauge theories endowed with scale invariance at the classical level. At the classical level, take any gauge theory with Yukawa, quartic interactions, write the more general gauge theory with this feature, and just put to zero all mass terms in order to make the theory scale invariant, classically. So you will find that this theory also possesses a tensor like that, okay? All these theories possess such a tensor, and it can always be made also, they're also intrinsically conformal invariant, okay? So this is not just a peculiarity. It happens certainly in all the classical examples in four dimensions. Now, let me give you an example, okay? Let me give you an example of this. Take the example of the, let me give you an example, okay? Let me give you the example of the free. Which already occurred in our discussion. So the Lagrangian is 1/2 d phi square. You can derive the energy momentum tensor. T mu nu is d mu phi d nu phi minus eta mu nu over 2 d phi square. Okay. Now, no doubt that this system is invariant under scale transformations. Okay, we see it right away. There's no dimensionful parameter. It is scale invariant. Let's check all we said in this simple example. Less obvious about conformal invariant, but let's see. T mu mu. Let's consider T mu mu for this case. Okay, so T mu mu. You just take it's just d phi square 1. Minus 2, so it's minus d phi square. Does it look like a total derivative? Just to wake you up before lunch. Does it look like a total derivative? Yes? Integration by parts? No, I'm just looking at an operator. I'm not integrating by parts. It's an operator. There's no integral. No integration by parts. It's true that, good, you say that if I integrate it, then it's zero, you're saying. Then I said it must be a total derivative. Okay, let's see it then. You need equations of motion. Okay. So let's consider did I get the signs right? Yeah, I think I got all the signs right. Sorry. But anyway, you will check if I have all the signs right. Okay. So in fact, dphi square can be written as d mu phi minus phi d square phi. Okay. And on the equations of motion, which is what you have to assume when you are considering the conservation of the current, okay, it's supposed to be valid, you're doing things on shell, on the equations of motion, this drops, and therefore this is the total derivative, okay, so it's the total derivative of this term, but in fact, it's more than the total derivative, right, because this is phi d phi, so this is d phi square. So this is equal to d mu times 1/2 d mu, okay, let's put it up, of phi square, okay? So it's equal 1/2 d square phi square, or if you want, it's equal 1/2 d mu, eta mu nu phi square. Okay, let me write it like this. Okay, so this t mu mu is equal to minus this, plus this, minus this, minus this, minus this. I think I had a sign wrong before, okay? When I wrote t mu mu, there was a minus. If I say that v mu is equal d nu l mu nu, l nu, nu mu, then t mu mu is minus d dl, okay? So there was a minus, okay? So this t is minus that, and this quantity here is what plays the role of our l mu nu, okay? So l mu nu is equal to 1/2 eta mu nu phi square. And in fact, you can check in this, for this particular case, for the particular case of the free scalar, that if you apply this algorithm, which is, for instance, oh, sorry, I forgot to say, you can see all this discussion in a paper by Polchinski of 1988. I forgot the nuclear physics B. So you can apply this to our scalar using this definition of L, and what you would find in this case is that there is a new conserved Angular-Newton tensor which has the following form: theta mu nu is equal to t mu nu minus 1/6 d mu d nu minus eta mu nu d square phi square. And this Angular-Newton tensor is conserved, symmetric, and traceless, corresponding to the fact that the free massless scalar is both scale invariant and conformal invariant. Conformal invariance is in the Angular-Newton tensor. You don't see it right away, but you have to do this improvement. One last comment. So these are all comments that are, well, okay, I see. One last comment. What I want to say. One last comment which is relevant for what, hopefully, I will discuss Thursday and Friday. It is maybe Saturday at this stage. The what is the origin of this freedom, of this improvement? How can we interpret this improvement? Okay, is there a quick interpretation? In fact, there is. Now, the energy momentum tensor, you can view it either as the current that comes out of the Noether procedure for translations, okay? But you can also, there's also energy momentum tensor you can derive, a form of it that can derive more quickly by coupling your theory to the gauge field of translation, which is gravity, okay? So the energy momentum tensor can be defined in a quicker and perhaps neater way just by taking our Lagrangian, okay, and turning on gravity, okay, putting a metric and then putting a Lagrangian with the metric and our field, okay, and then the energy momentum tensor is simply two 1 over square root of g the variation of the Lagrange respect to g mu nu, of the action respect to g mu nu. Okay? And now, given the presence of this freedom in the definition of t mu nu, how does this freedom match to this procedure of defining t mu nu? How it does? Well, it does in the following way. When you working at the same number of derivatives, okay, of course we want to work at the same number of fields and derivatives. Here we have two fields and two derivatives, here two fields and two derivatives. When you turn on gravity, you in general have more terms that you can write than you would see in flat space. And in the case of the scalar, these are terms that involve curvature, okay? Terms that involve curvature are not visible in flat space, but they're like ghosts, phantoms that appear when you turn on gravity. But these terms do exist, and they may exist. And when you do the variation respect to g mu nu, they introduce additional contribution to the energy momentum tensor. And the specific case of the free scalar, okay, when you turn on gravity, the Lagrangian, okay, there's going to be the overall volume element. And then you have this, okay. But in general, you can add a term which involves the curvature and phi square, okay? And this term can have a coefficient that's up to you to choose. And this term, when you do the variation of the Ricci gives you precisely a term of this form. And the freedom is gotten this freedom, this definition of T precisely corresponds to choosing the coefficient to be 1/6, okay? And a scalar coupled to gravity in the following way is said to be conformally coupled. I will explain more probably on Saturday or Sunday what this implies. No, hopefully earlier, okay? But this is the story. Okay, and the improvement is precise in correspondence to that. And all other possible improvement, if you have a theory with particles with spin, then you can think of more improvement terms, okay? In some cases you have vectors, you could think, if you have vectors without gauge symmetry, you could even imagine improvements of this type, v mu, v nu, and so on and so forth. Okay, so in the case of a scalar, I can only think of this, working at the level of two fields and two derivatives. But in case of more general theories, there are more improvements one can think of. And the reason why, and the fact that the reason why t mu nu is related to, yeah, okay, the relation of the, nothing, I don't want to add this. Okay, now here comes the most important point. So the discussion of having a fixed point and the perturbation around it it's intrinsic to the picture. The only thing really genuinely intrinsic, unavoidable thing is scale invariance. Conformal invariance seems a little bit unrelated to that. I mean, it's an additional property, but it's not, it doesn't seem necessary to have a system which is scale invariant. Now, what is interesting and remarkable, and maybe not surprising, is that, as far as we know, in four dimensions, all unitary scale invariant theories are also conformal. And that's just a fact, okay? In two dimensions, there is a theorem to prove that. It's a theorem that was first established by Zamolodchikov, made robust by Polchinski. Further interesting view on that were added by Andrea Friedan and Latorre in the same ages, that is to say the 80s. You're an old guy, okay? So in two dimension, we understand very well how things go. Scale invariance implies conformal invariance. And in fact, in two dimension, conformal invariance has even a bigger impact, because the conformal group extends beyond the simple conformal transformation showed before. It's actually an infinite group. And this is the reason why two-dimensional conformal field theories are so well studied and so well understood. Now, in higher dimension, we know less, okay? We know much less. We have, as far as we can see, we have evidence that the same connection exists in four dimensions. We, in specific cases, we have proofs, general proofs. Otherwise, we have just by inspection. But we, in recent years, there's been progress in that. I also worked on that. I participated to this progress in nailing down the connection between scale invariance and conformal invariance, one implying the other. But as far as I can tell, as far as is my judgment, so we made progress. We are very close to proving that it is so, but I don't think we have yet a proof. Perhaps I'm just dumb, because other colleagues claim we basically have a proof. This is not something I will discuss. I will prove instead something else. I will prove that if you make the assumption, I will prove it on Friday, if you make a limiting assumption that your theory is not the most general scale invariant theory, but it is a scale invariant theory that sits at a fixed point, which is not very far from a conformal fixed point. So there's a conformal fixed point. Then there's a neighborhood in parameter space. And this neighborhood is a neighborhood where you can apply perturbation, small perturbation of this conformal invariant fixed point. Okay, you can treat it as small. The features of the theory are small deformation of it. And there are examples where in the neighborhood of this fixed point, there are other fixed points. Okay, like Banks-Zaks is an example of that. Now, what we were able to prove is that under those circumstances, all these fixed points are also conformal invariant. And that's a theorem. Okay, this is basically a theorem. But I don't think we have yet able to prove that very far away from this fixed point, there's another fixed point with features completely different, and that is also scale invariant. Now, as you understand, these are important issues, because it's the very essence of our understanding of quantum field theory. As I told you before, quantum field theory, the fact that is, you put all the general things, all the operators, then you flow. The flow can be described as a small deviation around the fixed point, and then the structure of the couples, and then in the infrared, some other coupling become large, the relevant one, you may flow to a new structure. So the whole essence of quantum field theory goes around fixed points. So understanding their nature, whether they are scale invariant or conformal invariant, it's the utmost importance for our understanding of quantum field theory and therefore of particle physics, okay? And the second part of my course is meant to be that, is meant to describe that. What I now, instead of, I'm going to say is I'm now going to go back again. Now we're going to go to lunch, in fact. Now, meaning tomorrow, I'm going to go back again to phenomenology and describe the origin of hierarchies. So it's essential to have all the simplicity of particle physics. The essential thing is to have a separation of scale, namely that the theory should flow. If the theory doesn't flow, it cannot purify itself from all the relevant couplings. Okay, if you're stuck at one scale, you have all the structure. You necessarily need to have a separation of scales to have this simplification, which is a simplification way that we see in nature. The standard model is damn simple. Okay? So what I'm now going to discuss, what I will discuss tomorrow, is under what condition the separation of scales is natural. And this is a tricky point because the naturalness, and I will have to introduce the notion of naturalness. Okay, we'll see it tomorrow. Okay, thank you.
Questions?
Sticking to flat space, is there any observable difference in using one energy momentum tensor or the other?
In flat space? No, they're both good. So for instance, the corresponding energies are the same. So if you compute the global, of course, the coupling to gravity is different, okay? But as far as ordinary quantum field theory, no, it just, they're equivalent classes of currents whose corresponding conserved charge are the same because they differ by total derivative. No, it's just a choice, it's just a different choice of operator basis. I'm just changing a basis to make physics more manifest. But the notion of energy and momentum, which is the conserved charges, is unaffected by this.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so am I right that standard model is not scale invariant?
Well, it is approximately scale invariant. At energies above the Higgs mass, it's approximately scale invariant.
Yeah.
It's approximately free. It's scale invariant. So if you compute the trace of the energy momentum tensor, let's put it this way. A good way to quantify how scale invariant a theory is, compute the divergence of the dilatation current and see whether it's a small operator or not. So the divergence of the dilatation current in the standard model will be, it's a scalar, okay, d mu as mu, it's a scalar, okay, so right in terms of operators. And it is at the classical level, it's just m square h square, the Higgs mass, you see what I say? Which means that when you go to very, very high energies, it's a small effect. At the quantum level, there are effects that are proportional to the beta functions, okay? And given that the theory is weakly coupled, the beta function times operators, these effects are as small as the beta function is small. So they are loop suppressed. So they're not of order one, they have order. If they say QED, order alpha over 4 pi, it's 1/1,000. So they have a suppression associated with the fact that the couplings run slowly. Okay? In that sense, it's small, but it's not zero. It's approximately small, it's zero, but it is not.
Okay, so in standard model, all our unscalable comes from beta functions at higher energies.
The dominant thing is coming from beta function.
At higher energies. But what I really can't understand, why do we need to have a fixed point in parameter space? For example, we have some, for example, standard models and parameters change with scales, with energy scales, but why there exists any fixed point at all? Why do you say that all the interesting
is... No, I'm just saying that, I'm not saying... It just happens to be so. If you look at a weakly coupled theory, like the one I discussed before, as soon as you say it's weakly coupled, it can be described in the following way. Okay. Let me say it in a different way. I can turn the argument the other way around. I don't know whether this is going to be clear. So you're asking me why are we interested in fixed points?
Yes.
Very good question. So imagine you have a theory that has two scales. You understand what I mean, right? It has a scale which is 1 meter and has a scale which is 1,000 kilometers. Or there's a scale which is 1 EV and M Planck. Let's say a theory has two scales. You understand what this means?
I believe yes, but
okay.
It depends.
No, because it's not. It's a subtle thing, okay? It's a subtle statement, okay? Okay, good. It's a good answer, I believe. Okay, so it's not yes, it's not no, it's yeah, more or less I understand what it means. So the theory has two scales, and let me specify better what this means. It means that there are two scales where something happens, the dynamic changes, but in the between, nothing much happens. If you have a theory which has two massive particles, okay, a weakly coupled theory, you do measurements in the between these two scales, in between these two scales, you may have a mild RG evolution of couplings, but roughly everything behaves as massless.
So
when you reach one scale, when you reach one lower scale, you realize that one particle has mass, so this is a dramatic change. And when you reach the upper scale, you realize that there are more degrees of freedom. That's another dramatic change. But in the between, things don't change much. So in the between, the theory is approximately scale invariant. So in all situations where you have two separation of scales, the theory in the between is by definition, if you want, it's a tautology, scale invariant. Hence, but separation of scales is what we understand we need to have simplification, purification, like a theory which has only a few parameters, because the structure of the couples, when you look at long distance, something which has a little structure at short distances, like the cow from far away. So in order to have something simple, you need a separation of scales. And the separation of scales amounts at having a theory, which is a system which is approximately scale invariant. Then we want to understand what this is and what the properties are of theories with an approximate scale invariance.
So all our interest in physics in this region is lie in the deviation from scale invariant theory.
And also in the property of the scale invariant theory itself,
yes,
in the
yes,
garden variety of them. Yes. I can be like a zoologist, understand all possible. It's like understanding all species. A species is a conformal theory. And then there are least variation, which are all these individuals. Like it's, yeah, yeah. It's, if you want, that's the, it's a sort of Linnaeus classification.
Thank you.
Other questions? Okay, we thank Ricardo again.